The Robe of Peace by O. Henry. Mysteries follow one another so closely in a great city that the reading public and the friends of Johnny Bellchambers have ceased to marvel at his sudden and unexplained disappearance nearly a year ago. This particular mystery has now been cleared up, but the solution is so strange and incredible to the mind of the average man that only a select few who are in close touch with Bellchambers will give it full credence. Johnny Bellchambers, as is well known, belonged to the intrinsically inner circle of the elite. Without any of the ostentation of the fashionable ones who endeavor to attract notice by the eccentric display of wealth and show, he still was au fait in everything that gave deserved luster to his high position in the ranks of society. Especially did he shine in the matter of dress. In this, he was the despair of imitators. Always correct, exquisitely groomed, and possessed of an unlimited wardrobe, he was conceded to be the best-dressed man in New York, and therefore in America. There is not a tailor in Gotham who not have deemed it a precious boon to have been granted the privilege of making Bellchambers' clothes without a cent of pay. As he wore them, they would have been a priceless advertisement. Trousers were his special passion. Here, nothing but perfection would he notice. He would have worn a patch as quickly as he would have overlooked a wrinkle. He kept a man in his apartments always busy, pressing his ample supply. His friends said that 3 hours was the limit of time that he would wear these garments without exchanging. Bellchambers disappeared very suddenly. For 3 days his absence brought no alarm to his friends, and then they began to operate the usual methods of inquiry. All of them failed. He had left absolutely no trace behind. Then the search for a motive was instituted, but none was found. He had no enemies, he had no debts, and there was no woman. There were several thousand dollars in his bank to his credit. He had never showed any tendency towards mental eccentricity. In fact, he was of a particularly calm and well-balanced temperament. Every means of tracing the vanished man was made use of, but without avail. It was one of those cases, more numerous in late years, where men seem to have gone out like the flame of a candle, leaving not even a trail of smoke as a witness. In May, Tom Ayers and Lancelot Gilliam, two of Bellchambers' old friends, went for a little run on the other side. While pottering around in Italy and Switzerland, they happened one day to hear of a monastery in the Swiss Alps that promised something outside of the ordinary tourist beguiling attractions. The monastery was almost inaccessible to the average sightseer, being on an extremely rugged and precipitous spur of the mountains. The attractions it possessed but did not advertise were first an exclusive and divine cordial made by the monks that was said to far surpass Benedictine and Chartreuse. Next, a huge brass bell so purely and accurately cast that it had not ceased sounding since it was first rung 300 years ago. Finally, it was asserted that no Englishman had ever set foot within its walls. Ayers and Gilliam decided that these three reports called for investigation. It took them 2 days with the aid of two guides to reach the monastery of St. Grindrau. It stood upon a frozen, windswept crag with the snow piled about it in treacherous, drifting masses. They were hospitably received by the brothers whose duty it was to entertain the infrequent guest. They drank of the precious cordial, finding it rarely potent and reviving. They listened to the great ever-echoing bell and learned that they were pioneer travelers in those gray stone walls over the Englishmen whose restless feet have trodden nearly every corner of the earth. At 3 o'clock in the afternoon, they arrived. The two young Gothamites stood with the good brother Christopher in the great cold hallway of the monastery to watch the monks march past on their way to the refectory. They came slowly, pacing by twos, with their heads bowed, treading noiselessly with sandaled feet upon the rough stone flags. As the procession slowly filed past, Ayers suddenly gripped Gilliam by the arm. "Look," he whispered eagerly, "at the one just opposite you now, the one on this side with his hand at his waist. Well, if that isn't Johnny Bellchambers, then I never saw him." Gilliam saw and recognized the lost glass of fashion. "What the deuce," said he wonderedly, "is old Bell doing here? Tommy, it surely can't be he. Never heard of Bell having a turn for the religious. Well, fact is, I've heard him say things when a four in hand didn't seem to tie up just right that would bring him up for a court-martial before any church." "It's Bell, without a doubt," said Ayers firmly, "or I'm pretty badly in need of an oculist. But think of Johnny Bellchambers, the Royal High Chancellor of Swell Togs and the Mahatma of Pink Tees, up here in cold storage doing penance in a snuff-colored bathrobe. Well, I can't get it straight in my mind. Let's ask the jolly old boy that's doing the honors." Brother Christopher was appealed to for information. By that time, the monks had passed into the refectory. He could not tell to which one they referred. Bell chambers. Ah, the brothers of St. Gondra abandoned their worldly names when they took the vows. Did the gentleman wish to speak with one of the brothers? If they would come to the refectory and indicate the one they wished to see, the Reverend Abbot in authority would doubtless permit it. Ayers and Gilliam went to the dining hall and pointed out to Brother Christopher the man they'd seen. Yes, it was Johnny Bellchambers. They saw his face plainly now as he sat among the dingy brothers, never looking up, eating broth from a coarse brown bowl. Permission to speak to one of the brothers was granted to the two travelers by the abbot, and they waited in a reception room for him to come. When he did come, treading softly in his sandals, both Ayers and Gilliam looked at him in perplexity and astonishment. It was Johnny Bellchambers, but he had a different look. Upon his smooth-shaven face was an expression of ineffable peace, of rapturous attainment, of perfect and complete happiness. His form was proudly erect. His eyes shone with serene and gracious light. He was as neat and well-groomed as in the old New York days, but how differently was he clad. Now he seemed clothed in but a single garment, a long robe of rough brown cloth, gathered by a cord at the waist, and falling in straight loose folds nearly to his feet. He shook hands with his visitors with his old ease and grace of manner. If there was any embarrassment in that meeting, it was not manifested by Johnny Bellchambers. The room had no seats. They stood to converse. "Well, glad to see you, old man," said Ayers, somewhat awkwardly. "Wasn't expecting to find you up here. Not a bad idea, though, after all. Society's an awful sham. Must be a relief to shake the giddy whirl and retire to contemplation and prayer and hymns and those things." "Oh, cut that, Tommy," said Bellchambers cheerfully. "Don't be afraid that I'll pass around the plate. I'll go through these thingamabobs with the rest of these old boys because they are the rules. I'm Brother Ambrose here, you know. I'm given just 10 minutes to talk to you fellows. That's rather a new design and waistcoat you have on, isn't it, Gilliam? Are they wearing those things on Broadway now?" "It's the same old Johnny," said Gilliam joyfully. "What the devil? I mean, why? Oh, confound it. What'd you do it for, old man?" "Peel the bathrobe," pleaded Ayers almost tearfully, "and go back with us. The old crowd'll go wild to see you." "This isn't in your line, Bell. I know half a dozen girls that wore the willow on the quiet when you shook us in that unaccountable way. Hand in your resignation, or get a dispensation, or whatever you have to do to get a release from this ice factory. You'll get catarrh here, Johnny, and, my God, you don't have any socks on." Bellchambers looked down at his sandaled feet and smiled. "You fellows don't understand," he said soothingly. "It's nice of you to want me to go back, but the old life will never know me again. I've reached here the goal of all of my ambitions. I'm entirely happy and contented. Here I shall remain for the remainder of my days. You see this robe that I wear?" Bellchambers caressingly touched the straight-hanging garment. "At last I found something that will not bag at the knees. I have attained." At that moment, the deep boom of the great brass bell reverberated through the monastery. It must have been a summons to immediate devotions, for Brother Ambrose bowed his head, turned, and left the chamber without another word. A slight wave of his hand as he passed through the stone doorway seemed to say a farewell to his old friends. They left the monastery without seeing him again. And this is the story that Tommy Ayers and Lancelot Gilliam brought back with them from their latest European tour.